AM is 5:28. Hear our prayer, a shelter in time as well. Solomon's observation, rich rules over the poor, and the borrower is a servant to the lender. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 7. Debt allows furnishings in an apartment, going on a trip, or buying a vehicle without the discipline of keeping to a budget, saving or delayed gratification. The results are a life with stress, inability to pursue God's calling in life, or even to give for God's cause. May our time, treasure, talents, and temple be in harmony and honor God. Deacons, please come forward.
Friday, And Shemi's mom said, I wonder what we shall fix for Sabbath tomorrow. And she said, I have an idea, Mommy. And she ran and she got the recipe book and she started looking through. And she said, why don't we make it simple? We can make a fruit salad that can serve for us to eat day and as a dessert. And we can also have wraps. And maybe, Mommy, you can fix, I can fix the fruit salad. You can fix some tofu. And we can put it in the wraps. And maybe my sister can fix a cornbread. How about that, Mommy? It's simple. And it will taste good in all of us like that, right? So Mom said, okay, we can stick with that for our Sabbath lunch. What do you think about that? Cornbread, fruit salad, and tofu in a wrap. Now, I didn't make the fruit salad because I didn't want to make a lot of fruit salad. We're not having potluck as such. And so this is just some fruits. Those who don't like fruit salad, they could have that. Or pineapples, if you want to make a fruit salad. Or apples, or blueberries, or whatever it is. But she had watermelon, blueberries, grapes, and some other fruits. And so Shemi made her little fruit salad, and then they had wraps. And nowadays, they have all different kinds of wraps. And this one turned out to be a multi-grain with flax and so on. But she said, well, simple. So she went ahead and they prepared for Sabbath. And was that a lot of preparation? No, she said, Mommy, you cook all wheat. We always have good food to eat. Why on Sabbath we can't make it simple? Now, does your mom have to cook a lot on Friday? Does she have to do a lot of preparation? Yeah, so when Shemi came up with this idea, she said, and you know what happened? Sabbath came, and Shemi set the table, and her mom said, we are going to have a guest. So put a few more plates. And she said, okay, Mommy, I'll do that. And she fixed the table, and she brought up her fruit salad, and her mom had tofu prepared from Friday, and she just reheated it. And the wraps, the mom put a little skillet on the stove and she just had to heat the wraps a little bit. Heat the tofu a little bit. And Sabbath dinner was there and her sister had made a cornbread, cut it up nicely and they put it. Everybody ate and they were satisfied. And then they talked for a while and then the mom said, what about going for a walk? What about girls? Would you like to go for a walk? And asked the visitors if they would like to go for a walk and they went for a walk. Well, they had to go up a little hill. It was kind of difficult for them to climb, but they went up the hill so they can see all around. And they saw the beautiful scenery around, and they looked at the neighbors' yards, and they had flowers, and just looked around, and then Mom took them to a little side road, and there were holes. And she said, you know what, those are snake holes. Just keep on the path. Don't go where you see the holes. And she should show them different things of nature and show the visitors too, and they talked and they visited. Well, they stayed for a while and the sun was setting now. And she said, look at it, it's sunset. The sun is setting, let's head for home. And they headed for home. And as they got home, they looked and beyond it, there was the sun setting and they saw a beautiful sunset. And they enjoyed the Sabbath. Now I want to ask you boys and girls, Shemi have a good idea about Sabbath preparation? Or do you think they should have fixed a lot more food? Tell me what you think. They're always satisfied. They could climb up that hill. They hadn't eaten too much. Their tummies were not heavy. And they didn't just, because sometimes when you're eating, you know, and you're someone, you're talking and you have friends and so on, you forget how much you eat and then you feel stuffed. You don't feel like doing anything. Has that ever happened to you? Yeah. And so I think her idea was good. Then small, and then they had a good family time, a good time with their neighbors, and mommy didn't have as much work. Right? And do you think mommy was happy too? She was happy. The visitors were happy, and they had a good time. And so, now I know you guys will probably eat some of this, but after we finish church and song, if you want some of the fruits, and I didn't have everything that Chevy prepared, it had watermelon and blueberries and whatever not, but she did a good job fixing and helping mommy. And I hope you boys and girls, I know you help your mom at home, but try to get some recipe and tell her what? Make it what? Simple. Make it, oh, our church family are here. Make it simple for a potluck stew. What do you think about it, Sister Jo? I know you like to have a lot of fun, but can we have it simple so that these people wouldn't be bogged down and go home to sleep, but they'll think about going to walk and enjoy the Sabbath? What do you think about it, everybody?
Wonderful.
Make it simple. The Sabbath is there for us to enjoy fellowship with each other and enjoy God's nature, isn't it? Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for all the good fruits and food and everything he has prepared for us. Lord, help us to enjoy the Sabbath. Help us to enjoy each other and help us to be helpful to each other too. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, boys and girls.
Special reading today.
Good morning, blessed Sabbath. And look, one thing, we got rain today, but the sunshine shining here, all that matters. The reading comes from John chapter 15, verse 5. I like to read it twice. It's from the New King James. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bear much fruit. For without you, you can do nothing. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bear much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Thank you.
The reading today is John 16, verse 33. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. And overcome the world. Steve, Brother Steve's giving the message.
Shall we pray?
Thank you, Father, that we may gather together as brothers and sisters this morning and open your word and study your word and learn more about Jesus, more about walking with him, abiding in him. I ask, Father, a fresh anointing of your Holy Spirit upon my lips. The message may be clear and simple, and that we may understand the path of eternal life. And thank you for sending your Son to die in our place. In Jesus' name we pray. Julius was a centurion. That meant he was a Roman soldier, and he was in charge of 100 other soldiers. He was from Augustus' guard, which means he would have been one of the elite men. And the first time we have him encountering Paul was when Paul had been arrested and escorted by night, both by 200 soldiers, to the city of Caesarea. Paul had been arrested in Jerusalem because of the Jewish fanaticism. He was accused of teaching against the Jewish religion. And there was so much agitation, so much turmoil in that city, that Paul realized he could not receive a fair trial there. And so he made an appeal to Caesar. And in the midst of the turmoil that was going on, Paul's nephew heard that there was a plot on foot that the 40 men had taken a vow that they would not eat or drink until they had killed Paul. Paul asked his nephew to go tell Hephaestus, the Roman curator, governor there in Jerusalem. And so when Hephaestus heard that, he immediately commissioned 200 soldiers to secret Paul out by night and take him to Caesarea. There was no hope of him getting a fair trial in Jerusalem. So Paul is secreted out of the walls of Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem, by night, taken to Caesarea. And now we see his first encounter with Julius, the centurion. Agrippa was kind of ashamed. Paul had appealed to go to Caesar, but Agrippa was ashamed because he had nothing to write in the letter when Paul was going to appear before Caesar what his charges were. So Agrippa decided there needed to be a trial there in Caesarea. So they had a trial in Caesarea. And there Agrippa and Festa met and decided that there was nothing really worthy that they could write on the paper to accuse Paul. And they said, in fact, if Paul had not appealed to Caesar, he could have been let free. And this is where we find Julius, who probably was not involved not only in observing the trial, but in defending Paul, protecting his life. I brought a picture of a sailing vessel, something possibly of that time. Julius was in charge of taking Paul to Rome. As prisoners were escorted across the land, they were generally manacled, and they were manacled to one other prisoner. He would not have been manacled to Julius. Julius was the centurion. He was in charge of all the soldiers that had all the prisoners. And they set out from Caesarea. Now, generally, when the soldiers and the prisoners were put on board, they were free to their manacles, or the manacles taken off, the soldier remained on the prisoner. Sometimes in the artistic rendition of poets in the time of Christ, we see this vessel that might hold 20 or 30 people, like when Christ was out in the Sea of Galilee with his disciples and a storm blew up. But I wanted to get a picture to show you that this wasn't just a vessel for 20 or 30 people. This was a vessel that could hold almost 300 people. There were 276 on board. And here it is calmly on, sitting in a bay here. So they get on the boat, and they head off to Sidon, which is a short jump up the sea. And we got, does the next screen show the map? I have my map here. Thank you, Nick, for accommodating my request. They started here in Caesarea. This is Paul's last journey, and then they jump up to Sidon. And in Sidon, there are some Christian believers. And Julius allows Paul to leave the boat and go get some fellowship and some nourishment for the trip that's before them. Paul was not expecting to go on a trip to Rome when he was in Jerusalem. He was hastily arrested and escorted about. So it was quite a relief to Paul to spend some fellowship with his brothers there. I'd like to suggest that when Julius was observing Paul in the courtroom, that Paul was probably one of the few calm people in that whole scene. Annas, the high priest, had made a trip up from Jerusalem with specific purpose of having Paul put to death. And of course, he didn't come by himself. And the courtroom was noisy. And the soldiers were there to protect Paul. And Annas and Julius had an opportunity to observe Paul. And by this time, Paul had already begun to win his confidence, because Julius allowed him to leave the boat and go visit his friends. We're going to study this morning, what does it mean you have experimental religion? And we're going to be studying the example of Julius, a Roman centurion who probably didn't know God. The average Roman citizen had some vagaries, generally. They were religious, but not based upon the scripture, based more upon either Greek mythology or their Roman teachings. So we're starting with a man who knew little about God, and we're going to learn what does it mean to have an experimental religion. Not just a religion of theory, but a religion of practice. When the Roman centurion was riding on a boat, he was in charge of the boat. And we'll find that out later. He made the decisions on when the boat came and went. He had more authority than the captain or the owner. He could command a vessel if he was on Caesar's mission, and that's exactly what happened. They left Sidon. They came up here. We're told it was already late in the season. It was already after the Day of Atonement, and according to Jewish tradition, the Jews didn't sail or travel after the Day of Atonement. Anybody know why?
Storms.
It would get too stormy. But the Romans didn't follow that. That was a Jewish tradition, they didn't follow that. So anyway, normally they would have sailed directly across the Mediterranean here, but because of the adverse wind conditions, they hung up north, and they sailed the north side of Cyprus, and they came to Myra. And in Myra, the centurion commissioned an Alexandrian boat, one similar to the one we saw back there, a boat that would accommodate almost 300 people. And then they set out, and because of the bad winds, they dropped down south of Crete, and they came into a place called Fair Havens. Fair Havens was a small town, and it wasn't very homogeneous. And they had a conference in that town because they realized that the weather was turning bad. And the question wasn't, are we going to sail to Italy? That question was already decided. They could not sail to Italy. The weather was too bad. But what they had to decide was, were they going to stay? Oh, thank you. The question wasn't, are they going to sail to Italy, which, were they going to go to Rome up here? The question was, are they going to stay in Fair Havens, which is right here, or are they going to sail to Phoenix? Unfortunately, this map doesn't have it, but Phoenix is just down the coast, 30 miles. It would be a short afternoon sail. And so the centurion took counsel of the boat owner, of the other soldiers, and actually also the sailors, prisoners, and everybody decided, popular vote, that they didn't want to stay in Fair Havens because it was a miserable place to spend 3 months. We have to winter over there. What was there to do in Fair Havens? But if they would just do a 30-mile sail down the coast, and then have a very nice place to spend the winter. And so the centurion asked what they would like to do, and they all decided that they wanted to make the trip to Fairhaven, to Phoenix. Paul, however, weighed in on the discussion. He said, "Brethren, it seems to me that if we sail now, we're taking an unnecessary risk. At this time of year, the storms can be violent enough to damage your ship, force you to throw your cargo overboard, and could even cause you to lose your lives." Well, the centurion decided he would not follow Paul's advice. I mean, after all, he was just a prisoner. And there were almost 300 people there. And they almost unanimously voted that they wanted to make this little short jump over to spend a nice place for the winter quarters. Who would want to spend 3 months in an out-of-the-way, unprovisioned place? If you've got another, can we look at the next slide here? Thank you for coming.